a compendium of information from the earliest of our existence in this country up to the present. I really recommend, highly recommend that you get this book, The History of Black Business in America by Juliet E.K. Walker. She starts out with a quote that I love from an enslaved African in 1787, and he did write a book. His name is Guguano. And he said, "But I must own to the shame of my own countrymen that I was first kidnapped and betrayed by some of my own complexion, who were the first cause of my exile and slavery. But," he says, "if there were no buyers, there would be no sellers." So, Brother Guguano sets the tone for our existence in this country. Yes, he acknowledges that some Africans were sold, were betrayed. We're doing the same thing today. We're selling one another out, and we're betraying one another. So don't look back on our brothers and sisters in Africa and say, "Whoa, look what they did." Look at what we're doing today. The most educated, the wealthiest black people on the face of the earth, right here, some of whom are right here in Cincinnati, still selling their brothers and sisters out, and still doing the kinds of things that are detrimental to our people. So I guess the saga continues, right? But this book starts out setting the tone on the commercial aspects of Africans prior to the time that we came to this country, and then gets into business side, the entrepreneurial aspects of black people in this country in the 1600s. Very interesting, very enlightening. Every family should have this book. Every black person should read this book and understand a lot more about ourselves in our early existence in this country. Blacks did not become entrepreneurs when we reached this country. I want to make that clear. We didn't become entrepreneurs. We weren't given the skills and taught how to be entrepreneurs. We had that before we got here. And this notion now that's being promulgated over the past 20 years or so is that black people are reluctant to be entrepreneurs. Black people are really not inclined to do that. They're disinclined. They only want to have jobs. They only want to work for someone else. They don't want to have their own businesses. You know, that's being promoted. And I said 20 years, but probably over the last 30 years. Because prior to, if you look back in recent history, prior to, say, 1960, all you saw were black entrepreneurs. Yes, a lot of people worked in the big plants in Michigan and Ohio and Illinois. You know, they came up from the South to get jobs in the auto manufacturing business. But there were a lot of black entrepreneurs prior to, a lot more than we have now proportionately, prior to 1960. So don't be taught or don't get the idea that black people did not gravitate toward entrepreneurship because, as one myth says, we were lazy. The term lazy slave is oxymoronic, wouldn't you think? Or because we were reluctant to do it, we didn't have the proclivity toward entrepreneurship, we didn't have the skills, we really didn't know how to do business. Come on. I could read you some quotes from Juliet Walker's book that will turn that myth on its ear and show you that black people have always had the proclivity toward entrepreneurship. It's how we had to survive. And how do you think black people survived prior to integration? Prior to even the 50s and the 40s, when this move toward public accommodation and civil rights started, how do you think we survived? So I want you to think about that as we go through this history of black business during Black History Month. Again, don't let people sell you your history. Don't let your history be commercialized. You need to know your history, especially black business history, because economics runs this country, runs the world. You need to be aware of it, and you need to be a part of it. So there was definitely a black business tradition that was derived from our African heritage when we were brought to this country. It was sunset in Africa, as I termed it, as we left, and it was sunrise in America because black people came. Black people were brought here. You know, there was land in this country, an abundance of land, but it wasn't worth anything until someone was enslaved and put on that land so that something could be grown out of that land and sold. A lot of it back to England at the time. We know about cotton and indigo and tobacco and all of those things that helped to build the wealth of this country. So it was sunrise in America when blacks got here. We have to understand that the whole notion of bringing all of our people to this country, millions, was grounded in economics. It was grounded in economics. And you can just look around today and see the results of that. You can still see the results of it. Why? Because there was so much wealth that was created. If you had a business and you were, say, fortunate enough to live for 200 years, and you employed 1,000 people, you never had to pay them. Come on. Would your business thrive? And we see these CEOs today. They come into a business. They're already making, say, $10, $12 million a year. They lay off a lot of people. They get a raise. They get a raise. Oh, you did well. You fired some people, so we're going to increase your salary. And you also created higher productivity. So we're going to give you more money. Of course, people doing the actual jobs, you know, our wages, real wages, haven't gone up at all. But imagine yourself owning a company like that and having free labor for that long a period of time. You can't help but prosper. And that's what happened in this country. Obviously, well, we know that because, you know, we know that particular part of our history. So the economics of free labor came into effect big time back then. Black people were not allowed to not only get paid, but were not allowed to do business in the general marketplace. And in many cases, were not allowed to own land. But in some cases, black people like Anthony Johnson and others did own land, and they did quite well with that. So the earliest of entrepreneurs, you know, like I said, goes back to around the 1650s, and then we bring it forward. And this was done against all odds, against all odds. Black people took their lives in their own hands, risked their lives to have businesses. I never hear it quoted when it comes to entrepreneurship, like I do when it comes to voting. Black people died so we could vote. Yes, that's true. But black people also died to have businesses in this country. That should also be quoted and passed on to our children when it comes to entrepreneurship, that black people risk their lives. And as we move forward in this, in these two programs, we'll see, especially in places like Tulsa, Oklahoma, where a lot of black people did die simply because they had businesses and they prospered in those businesses. So, you know, we participated in agriculture, of course. There were techniques in harvesting and working the land that Africans knew about, that when they were brought here, those techniques were shared and helped this country prosper. Africans knew how to invent and to make things. And there's this whole argument going around now about what Africans invented and what they didn't invent. But Africans were craftsmen, they were herdsmen, they were blacksmiths. They did all kinds of things. And they brought those skills to this country and used them to help build the wealth in this country. And once again, I say it was against all odds because public policy dictated that all income from slave laborers was owed to the slave owners. Can you imagine yourself going to work every week and the money you make goes right back to the guy you're working for? Just think about that. Everything that you made, he really owned. If you think about the mining industry, for instance, on my mother's side, my relatives worked in the mines in West Virginia, down around Beckley, West Virginia. A lot of my uncles worked there. My great-grandfather worked there, and my grandfather worked there. And they owed, at the end of the week, when they got paid, they owed, you heard that song, who was that guy, Ernie somebody, made a song, "I Owe My Soul to the Company Store." I went down to West Virginia. We used to go down there in the summertime. And when I got older, I went down and saw this place where my mother was raised, and they call them hollows down there. And they're between these two mountains. I mean, it got dark there about an hour before it got dark out on the road. It was so deep back up in the mountains. And I actually got to go in the mines and see my uncles go to work and everything. And, you know, I saw this company store, too. The company would build these shacks in the hollow where people would live, and they would sell them everything they needed. And at the end of the week, when they got paid, they had to take their money and give it to the company store. And that system just perpetuated itself. Now, you know somebody was making money. Somebody was making a lot of money. And until John L. Lewis came along and helped to reform the whole mining industry, you know, there were some folks, black and white, you know, getting exploited big time in the mines. A very dangerous, probably the most dangerous job that you could have back there, because a couple of my uncles died from black lung disease. A lot of people died from black lung disease. And it was so pronounced and pervasive that the government set up a black lung fund, and they would get checks every month because they had this disease from working in the mines and breathing that coal dust. A very dangerous job. But the company store reminded me of the whole slave system and sharecropping system and all the things that our people have been through in this country. So the public policy dictated a lot of things around how we could participate in business back in the 1600s and 1700s. But black people still persisted, still took the risk, still got out there and negotiated with slave owners to have a little plot of land that they could work and raise some produce and sell it to somebody. So they became entrepreneurs even while enslaved, in some cases. And it went on from there. So our people did overcome. Right here in Cincinnati, as I said, Cincinnati has a glowing history of black enterprise. In around 1835, Cincinnati and Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, were the two leading black enterprises in this country. And there was a guy named Anthony Gordon, who was a former slave, came here from Virginia. He started a coal dealership or coal business down on the riverfront. And this was around 1846. And he accumulated $15,000. That was like $1 million today. And this was a former enslaved African, Anthony Gordon, a very famous name that came out of Cincinnati, Ohio. There was a guy named Anthony Weston, who was a millwright, another former slave. Of course, he accumulated $40,000 during his lifetime. A guy named Free Frank, now he's an interesting brother. He started the first black town in this country called New Philadelphia, Illinois. And coincidentally, Free Frank is the great-great-grandfather of Juliet E.K. Walker, who wrote the book, The History of Black Business in America. And of course, she did her research and found that out about her relatives, and that led to her doing more research and writing all of the wonderful information she's produced about black business in this country. And there was a guy named Lunsford Lane. He was a tobacconist. He understood that, you know, folks like tobacco, to chew it and make snuff out of it. You remember snuff? That's another thing some of our relatives used to do, stick it down in their lip. You know, my grandmother on my father's side used to do it. And the two little old ladies who lived downstairs from us on York Street, they used snuff. And I remember going to the store for them. Bruton snuff. I still remember the little can, red and white can, Bruton snuff. I'd run to the store for them and get their snuff, and they'd stick it down in their lip, and lip would bulge out, you know. And those are memories that I have from growing up here in Cincinnati. But Lunsford Lane was a tobacconist, and he was like the prototypical slave.